Psalm 138, just quickly, just looking at some of our theme scriptures. We're talking about the way and the walk, and we're in part three of a segment in that series called The High Fives of Our Calling. And Psalm 138, verse 8 said, the Lord will what? Come on, you should know this by now. The Lord will perfect. The Lord will perfect. Who will? The Lord will perfect. Are you supposed to be trying and striving and wearing yourself out to try and perfect what He's called you to do? No. Now, you're supposed to put some effort towards it, but sanctified effort. That means by faith. That means it's you're entering into His rest. That means you're working hard at entering into Him, but not trying to work hard to make things come to pass. You don't have to kick the doors down. You have to trust in God and let God open. No, the gates of hell can't prevail against you. You understand that? Hallelujah. But it's in you. The context is in you as the church, as in us as the church, the ecclesia, and there's an authority as a part of that. So it says, the Lord will perfect that which concerns me. He's committed to that. Your mercy, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. The New Living said, the Lord will work out His plans for my life. Hallelujah. Jeremiah 29:11 in the Amplified, for I know the thoughts and plans that I have for you, says the Lord, thoughts and plans for welfare and peace, not for evil, to give you a hope. You can sing this with me if you want to. In your final outcome. All right, yeah, very good. And then we move on to Psalm 25, the Passion Translation. The Lord direct me throughout my journey, so I can experience your plans for my life. Reveal the life plans that are pleasing to you. Escort me along the way. Take me by the hand and teach me, for you are the God of my increasing salvation. I have wrapped my heart into yours. I just love that. I just love that. Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher, perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was... Your future is a joy. Man, I think sometimes we've forgotten that. Sometimes we need reminding of that. Your future is a joy. Praise God. It's looking up. Say, it's looking up. Say, my future is looking bright. Because I'm in Christ. Amen. Praise God. He's the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross. Man, if you can endure the cross with joy, my goodness. I mean, what was the perspective? For the joy that was set before us, what was He focusing on? The nails, the splinters, the whips, the chains? Well, no, He was focusing on you, the precious fruit of the earth, for the joy that was set before Him, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Well, Hebrews 5:9 says, having been perfected, He became the author of eternal salvation to all those who obey Him. Hallelujah. So those are the foundations of our understanding concerning the call of God and the destiny of God in us. Now, Romans 8 was the first of our three high fives. Yeah, just give a high five to someone next to you. Go on, just do it. You can do it. High five. All right, so this is the first of our three high fives. Remember, the homeschool high five, just by yourself. That's right. So praise God. The first of them was Romans chapter 8. And verses 29 and 30, and we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, those who are called according to His, whose purpose? His purpose, all right. And then it says, for whom He, and here's the 5 points, for whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, those He predestined, these He also called. Whom He called, He also justified. Whom He justified, these He also glorified. Hallelujah. So we looked at 5 points that He's foreknown us. He's predestined us. Remember, that predestined is not that you haven't got a choice. It's a path that's been planned and written for you from before the foundation of the world that you have to say yes to, that you have to walk on. Remember that there's the two Hebrew words. There's the derech, which is the path, and there's the halach, which is the walk. The derech has been paved before you, but the choice to take the steps is yours. Hallelujah. Number three was these He also called. You are called of God. And that's when you start to tap into an understanding of the plan of God. Number four, these he also justified. He's made you right with him. He's enabled you to live out this life in him. He's justified you. He's sanctified you. We'll talk about that in a little while again. And these, number five, these he also glorified. Jesus said, the glory which you've given me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. There's a glory on the church. You know, Jesus is coming back for a glorious church, for a glorious a bride without spot or wrinkle. Did you know that? Hallelujah. He's not coming back for a church that's all busted and disgusted and broken down and weak and everything else. He's coming back for a glorious church. And the reason that Jesus said, the glory you've given me, I've given them, it's so that we would be one. Well, there's an anointing and a manifestation of the glory of God that's going to come upon the church, and his grace is going to bring us together in a unity and in a dynamic that we've never seen before, ever. I believe that with all of my heart. Hallelujah. And so part two, last week, we looked at 2 Timothy 1:9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. And those five elements we looked at, that we were called with a holy calling, not just a calling, but a sanctified calling, a holy calling. It's empowered by the Holy Spirit. You can't just have any old calling connected to the Holy Spirit. It's got, you can't make up your calling. You can't figure it out in your own head. You've got to receive it as a holy thing, sanctified. Number two, not according to our works. There's nothing you can do in and of your own strength to try to make this come to pass. Ask me how I know. I have tried way too many times to try to make things work, to try to promote myself. Thankfully, it's been a while since I've been done any of that junk. Praise God. My wife can testify to that. She can tell you that. But there's been times when I would do stuff and I didn't even realize I was doing it. And she'd just look at me and I'm like, oh, I'm doing it again, aren't I? So, you know, you're at a meeting or you're saying something, you're trying, and you're just trying to, you know, we don't need to do that junk. We humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. He will exalt us in due season. Amen. So it's not according to our own works, and we didn't do anything to get saved. We didn't do anything. It's not a works lest any man should boast. Hallelujah. Number three, according to his own purpose and grace. His purpose. We've got to be dedicated to his purpose. Hallelujah. And we're not driven by our own purpose. We're led by his purpose. And grace, which is the strength, the power, the sufficiency, and the ability to fulfill his purpose. Number four, given to us in Christ Jesus. Outside of Christ, there's nothing given to you. Outside of Christ, there's nothing that's worth having. But everything has been given to you, gifted to you in the anointed one and his anointing and in that salvation that's through him. Number five, before time began. So there in that meditation of that, we tap into the eternal. We tap into something that was written in heaven's books about you before, not even just before you were conceived. I mean, before the world was birthed. So you step into the Hebrew word is the olam, the everlasting. It's in Strong's, it describes it as the vanishing point. It's the point beyond the natural. And it's a point that has no, that where time and distance has no bearing on it. Hallelujah. Before time began. Praise God. Now, let's go into our third of the high fives. I want you to turn to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, praise God. And see if you can pick the five elements that I can see here in verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Hallelujah. Are you seeing a common thread in the scriptures that we're looking at? I mean, they're almost saying exactly the same thing. They're almost picking out almost exactly the same five points in all of these scriptures. You know, the Bible says that by a mouth of two or three witnesses, a man should be you know, is confirmed. And so we see in the same concepts over and over and over and over again, God drawing from the eternal concerning our destiny, our calling, our purpose. And so I see five elements here. His workmanship. We'll talk about that in a second. Created in Christ Jesus. We've spent some time in that. We'll revisit it. For good works, which God prepared beforehand. That's the eternal. That we should walk in them. So let's start out. Let's look at some of these. Hallelujah. Let's start thinking about His workmanship. Because this should set you free this morning. Some of you, you're going to need to hear this morning. I'm amazed when I teach on the discipleship training schools with YWAM, and as you heard Amy say, tomorrow we'll be jumping on a jet again in the morning and flying off to Kiwiland and teaching there for a few days there. When I teach these young people, it amazes me, constantly amazes me, how many young people I find, especially beautiful young ladies, who have the worst image of themselves. I mean, you just look at them and think, seriously? You know, I'm ugly, I'm fat, I'm stupid, and this is bombarding people's heads all the time. Not just girls, guys too. I mean, at any age, it would seem. It doesn't seem to be, you know, now it used to be sort of mostly around puberty and older. Now it just, I mean, it can be young little kids who've got these terrible images about themselves. Well, I want to tell you something. I mean, before Christ, you were a lousy, rotten, dirty, rotten sinner. But in Christ, you're a brand new creature. I mean, it's stunning in the eyes of Jesus. It's beautiful in the eyes of the Father. And you've got to see yourself through His eyes. I'm not talking about going around all puffed up because you didn't do anything to get this. He did it. Now listen to those. His workmanship. Now you've got to know that He's a master craftsman. You've got to know He is skilled in creativity. I mean, He's just to the tiniest of tiniest brushstroke. You know, to the tiniest of little pencil flicks in His workmanship, in His carving, of His design, His workmanship. So when a Christian puts themselves down and believes the lies, it's close to blasphemous. It's close to calling God a liar. Because it's His creation that you're aligning, you're maligning. It's God's handiwork. So we're not just talking about the outward appearance, of course. And in this one day when this you're going to get a new one of these anyway. We're talking about the whole thing, spirit, soul, and body. He sanctified you, spirit, soul, and body, to preserve you blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, you know, if there are things in bodily, and I'm not just talking about Holy Ghost plastic surgery, I know, well, God, I'd, you know, like a smaller nose. Well, my goodness, I've prayed that a few times. It never worked, you know. And then I went to Israel and I was really glad for it. Kind of, I fit in, you know. Oh, God, if my ears didn't quite stick out this much as a kid, would that really bother me? The old Dumbo and everything else that got called, because it grew into my ears a little bit. My ears were bigger and my face was smaller back then. But I went through all this stuff. But I'm telling you, in Christ, it's not about just the appearance. It's not about your physical things. It's not about that. And honestly, even that is beautiful in the eyes of the Lord. His workmanship. It's absolutely stunning before Him. Listen to a couple of different versions of this. In Ephesians 2:10 in the Amplified, for we are God's own handiwork, His workmanship. Listen to it in the New Living Translation. We are God's masterpiece. Wow. We are God's masterpiece. Can you imagine you get to heaven and if God had a living room and he had one picture there, would you be shocked if you walked in and the masterpiece that he had displayed, the only one on the wall, was a picture of you? Wouldn't that be amazing? You say, but God, he said, no, you don't understand. You're my masterpiece. And he sees every one of you like that. Every one of us would walk into that room and see a picture of ourselves. Listen to it in the Passion Translation. We have become his poetry. Isn't that beautiful? His poetry. A recreated people that will fulfill the destiny he has given each of us. For we are joined to Jesus, the Anointed One. Even before we were born, God planned in advance our destiny and the good works we would do to fulfill it. That's the Passion Translation. Isn't that beautiful? Poetry, masterpiece, handiwork, workmanship. This is God's perspective of you. Now, we should be enraptured in his presence and his beauty, but you've got to understand, he feels that way about you. He created you for his good pleasure. Not for him to maybe glance a thought at every now and then, for his good pleasure. Praise God. So we're created as workmanship, as masterpiece. Some of you need to tear down the stinking thinking, the wrong image that not only you've had, and some of you, there's those words that have been spoken over you from childhood. Stuff that's been said, it's just not true. You've got to throw it down. Let Jesus peel that away from you. And take it off. It's lies, it's false, it's just wrong. So let the Holy Spirit minister that to you this morning. Let there be a fresh revelation this morning through the eyes of God at how he absolutely, passionately joys over you as his creation. Hallelujah. Number two, created in Christ Jesus. Of course, this is linked. The creation, the handiwork, the beauty of what he's made is in Christ. So the image of Christ, the image and beauty of Jesus has been you've been made in that. There's a picture of him in you too. That's how it works. We've already spent a good bit of time looking over that, but understand that this new creation that we are in Christ is beautiful because Jesus also sees him in you. You know, we've been watching some, I got all our old VHS videos put onto DVD for Jilly for her birthday, and we've been watching the kids growing up, you know, from hospital to home and so forth and so on. And you can see resemblances and you can hear things and you can see stuff. And, you know, when Jesus looks at you, he sees Jesus' resemblance. He sees that in you. You're his brother. Jesus says he is not ashamed to call you brethren. Amen. That's what he says about you. Love what one man said. He said, he calls us brother, we call him Lord. But that's true. But the relational communication has been made that way. He was the firstborn among many what? Brethren. He's the first, and all of the rest of the brethren come through and from that. Amen. So 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 21 really sums it up for us. We know these verses well. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a what? New creation. All things have passed away. This is why you don't have to believe the laws, the lies and the curses and the rubbish and the garbage and everything else that was put on you. You've been made brand new. Now, sometimes people pick up the old generational stuff and the old stuff that was before. They pick it up again because the devil's got a vested interest in handing it to you again. But it doesn't belong to you. And the Christian that's walking around with all the old garbage from before, it's because they've believed lies, they've picked up on the old stuff, they've invested themselves again into the old things, and the devil's been more than happy to reinforce that in your life again. But according to this scripture, when you got recreated, old things have what? Passed away. That means they're dead. That's as dead as you can get. I mean, that's simple, right? Old things have passed away. Behold, how many? Are you sure about that? Wouldn't that mean everything then? All things have become what?
New.
Now. Say now.
Now.
When?
Now.
Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through who? Jesus Christ. And has given us. Now this is key. The what? The ministry of reconciliation. Now, when the Prime Minister forms a government, he forms a cabinet. And in that cabinet, he hands people ministries. The Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of, you know, Border Protection or whatever, and so forth and so on. Now, when you became born again in Christ, he handed you the ministry of Jesus. He handed me, he handed us as the body of Christ, the ministry of Jesus, which is what? The ministry of reconciliation. That is, and he describes it now, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. He was in Christ doing this, so this is Jesus' ministry. Not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Why? Well, Jesus isn't on the earth in that physical format anymore. We are here as his body. And so he's transferred that commission and that authority and that ministry to his body. He's still the head. Now then, when then? Now then, all right. We are, is another political or governmental, I should say, position. We are what? Ambassadors for what? For Christ. We're ambassadors. You carry, now an ambassador carries his country everywhere he goes. You can't be arrested on foreign soil as an ambassador. You have diplomatic immunity. Isn't that right? So if a cold tries to come on you, say no. I have diplomatic immunity to that cold. If poverty tries to come upon you, no, I've got diplomatic immunity. I'm not subject to the financial dealings of what surrounds me in this financial climate. I have immunity from that. I am connected to another kingdom which has no problem and no debt. And you hear what I'm saying now? You're an ambassador of heaven on assignment on the earth. And you have diplomatic immunity from heaven's council. All right, in heaven's council. Now, we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. This is what we plead. This is what the ministry of reconciliation says to those who need to hear it. We implore you on Christ's behalf. In other words, we are saying this on behalf of the anointed one and his anointing, in his place, in his footsteps, with his hands and with his mouth, with love looking through our eyes, love himself looking at you right now. We say this to you, be reconciled to God. And I'm going to make this statement. There is no such thing as true reconciliation between races outside of Christ. Outside of Jesus, there are attempts, but it simply doesn't work. Because forget race even. Any kind of difference finds itself in conflict outside of Christ. And if anything, we should lead the way in what it means. And I love to look around into this room and see different people from different nations, different colors, you know. This is a snapshot of eternity. And it's beautiful in the eyes of the Father. For he made him, this is our righteousness, you see. He made him who knew no sin, that be Jesus, to be sin. He became sin for you and me, that we might become the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. In him. So we are created in Christ Jesus. We are. We have to see ourselves that way. So that leads us to our next point in Ephesians 2:10, for good works. See, as that creation, with that new creation, very clearly in the passage we just looked at in 2 Corinthians, is what we're supposed to do as a new creation. We are supposed to take up our ministry position, we're supposed to take up our ambassadorship, and we're supposed to do the good works that we've been commissioned and charged and sent to do. Every one of you is an apostle in that sense. An apostle of Jesus in terms of being sent by him into all the world. Every one of you has been commissioned with a great commission to go. Hallelujah. For good works. He's committed to us the word of reconciliation. Our function then as ambassadors for the Anointed One and his anointing is to implore on Christ's behalf and to call people. To implore people, to share the love of God with people, to give them the gospel and bring them into that vital relationship with God. Revelation 19:10. Now I want you to hear this, because when you open your mouth on behalf of Christ and you speak his words and you testify of Jesus, you step into a supernatural dynamic that is empowered by the Holy Spirit under the spirit of prophecy. Now, New Testament prophecy, purely, is edification, exhortation, and comfort to men. We see that explained in Corinthians. That is New Testament prophecy. Now, within that can contain a word of wisdom and a word of knowledge and so forth. But purely it is edification, exhortation, and comfort. So every time anyone stands up to preach, it should be under the spirit of prophecy. And that's the spirit of Jesus. And sometimes within that we have words of knowledge and so forth and so on. But that's the same when you go to witness to someone. Now the Holy Spirit came upon the church. Jesus said, don't even try this. Go to Jerusalem. Wait for me. Don't even have a go at this yet until you are empowered from on high to be witnesses. So when we go and we witness and we share our faith, when we share the love of God with someone, we come under that same prophetic mantle of Jesus. Let me show it to you here. Revelation 19, verse 10. And I fell at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, see that you do not do that, because it's an angel. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. The testimony of Jesus. Worship God for the what? Testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Hallelujah. Exhortation. Building up. Exhortation. Edification, comfort to men. That's what we're supposed to do. And that's the works that we've been called to do. Amplified puts it this way. It says, for the substance, essence of the truth revealed by Jesus is the spirit of all prophecy, the vital breath, the inspiration of all inspired preaching, and the interpretation of the divine will and purpose, including both mine and yours. Well, they weren't kidding when they said amplified. But isn't that amazing? That's what comes upon us. Not upon just me in the pulpit. It does. I trust that it does every single time. I wouldn't stand up here and open my mouth. I wouldn't dare to if I didn't absolutely trust that that spirit of prophecy would come upon me to build you up. Wouldn't do it. I have more respect for that holy desk than that. But you should have the same expectation when you're sitting at a bus stop or going and sharing with a man at work or a lady at work or a person in your school or whatever it happens to be. And I'm going to tell you something. These kids are going to get a hold of this. You're going to see boldness already. This little sweetheart, someone came around to fix the washing machine. Dishwasher. Do you know God? Isn't that true? Just last week. Oh, that we would be that bold. Oh, that we would be that bold. There's going to come a day when they'll walk back into the kitchen, the guy will be on his knees and she'll be laying hands on his head and just praying in the spirit. And I'm telling you, this is going to happen. A little child will lead us. We're going to see the kids stepping up into things. And we better be ready. We better be ready to get in there and do the same stuff. My goodness. We're going to see things. Every historical revival, you study it out for yourselves. Every historical revival has seen a monumental move of God amongst the children. Every single one of them. Our kids in children's church, they pray in the Spirit together 15 minutes every week. They're not, you know, sticking felt stuff on things, just, you know, hoping that it looks like Noah's Ark. Now, there's nothing wrong with that in its basic, you know, please don't hear me wrong. But I'm telling you, they're being trained. You can start with that, but you've got to move on from that at some point, right? You can start with the felt stuff. There's nothing wrong with that. But our kids are hungry. They're doing it. Praise God. We better be ready. We better be up to pace with them. Praise the Lord. You and I were created anew, not just as new creations, but in Christ. We are designed. Now, if you've got a religious spirit this morning, you're about to react. So, you know, if anybody starts shaking, you know, just pray for them. You and I were created anew, not just as new creations, but in Christ, we are designed to function in the divine nature. Now, that'll mess with you a little bit. That'll mess with you. You can't be in Christ, and not function in Christ. Well, Christ is in the divine. You've got to understand that. And we've been placed in Him. Well, how does that work out? It was very simple. 2 Peter 1, 3 and 4 makes it very clear for us. As the divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be what? Partakers of what? The divine nature. Having escaped the corruption of the world through lust. Oh, my. It's beautiful. It's powerful. Number four, which God prepared beforehand. We won't go into that too much because we've already spent some time on that. Here again, we just have an understanding. We're tapping into eternity. We're tapping into what's been written in the books. We're tapping into what's been foreknown, preordained. The destination that God has for you. The substance of your day must be by faith. It's discovered by hearing the word rather than looking at the circumstances. The circumstances are out there. We're not denying those. But we walk by faith and not by sight. So the good works that we do and outwork through His divine nature, His power and His excellence in and through our lives by the Holy Spirit. In other words, it's done and it's outworked by faith on the substance of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Now listen to this. If you've been around a little while, you've heard us talk about this. You've heard Faye even mention this morning. To some degree, introducing that concept again into our time, we are the everlasting doors that the King of Glory comes in through. The Bible says, lift up your heads, O you gates, be lifted up, O you everlasting doors, and the King of Glory shall come in. Amen. You read that in its context. You do a little bit of digging in that. We're the doors. Well, Jesus ultimately is the door. But we've just figured this out. We've just talked about this. We are in Him, in Christ. Amen. And so we understand that. Now, number five then, the last point, that we should walk in them. Well, this is the way in the walk. He's provided the way. He is the way. And the truth and the life. Now, our halak, the halakha, is our walk. And so every rabbi took upon himself disciples. And every rabbi would walk. and every disciple would put his feet in the footsteps of his rabbi and want to be just like the rabbi. They would start to talk like the rabbi and walk like the rabbi and wash like the rabbi and eat like the rabbi and wear their clothes. I mean, their goal was to be so that somebody couldn't distinguish them from the rabbi when they heard them. And the greatest blessing you could ever say to a Talmid, a disciple, would may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, which meant that you get picked to be the closest one following behind, because as they walked to their sandals, you know, their flip-flops would flip up the dust and the person behind would get all the dust. But that was a great honor to be that close. That was a great honor to be that close. So the halak is the walk. So the disciples would actually look to try to actually, I mean, they're looking to step exactly where their rabbi steps. They were that intent, in that specific. Are we that intent on stepping in Jesus' footsteps? Because here's the beautiful part. He's made footsteps that are U-shaped. Not U-shaped. It's not a horse. No. Get on the same page with me right now. He's got footsteps that look like you, your feet. This is the grace of it. Do you understand this? You're not trying to put your feet into his shape. He's created a shape before you that looks like you, but he did it. So you're putting your foot in his footsteps, and it's fitting perfectly because he's written it to the tiniest detail. And it fits. It fits. It's right. But that's the easiest walk then. Have you ever tried to walk using someone else's shoes? We were watching these videos and Amy had on Jill's dad's boots. You know, and it's kind of, you know, I mean, it doesn't work, you know. I mean, she's doing her best to run around. But you can't wear someone else's anointing. You can't wear someone else's calling. You can't wear someone else's personality. You can't do this. Jesus has made the footsteps that look like you. He's created them for you, that we should walk in them. Galatians 5:25 says, if we live in the Spirit, let us also what? Walk in the Spirit. The Amplified says, if we live by the Holy Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. If by the Holy Spirit we have our life in God, let us go forward walking in line, our conduct controlled by the Spirit. Hallelujah. The New Living Translation says, since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. The Passion Translation says, we have now chosen to live in the surrendered freedom of yielding to the Holy Spirit. Isn't that beautiful? Why? We've become His poetry, His design. This year, as His masterpiece, His workmanship, His poetry, will you walk out your eternal destiny as an ambassador in the authority and name of the Anointed One by living that anointed manifestation? Will you walk it? I say yes. I'm saying yes. I'm saying yes to all of that. I'm saying yes to God healing my soul and the wrong images I've got of me and replacing them with what He says. I am who He says I am. I'm replacing all of the can'ts to all of the can-dos that are in His Word. You won't find anywhere it says that you can't. But all you find is, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthened me. Amen. I'm going to tear down all the words that were spoken over me that says you can't, you don't, you shouldn't, you mustn't, you're too this or too that, to, you know, could accomplish more if he applied himself. Anyway, that was written a lot of times. But that was back when it counted on my own ability and strength. But you know what? In Christ, all I'm now doing is leaning into Him. And that's all you need to do too. And then you just do everything He tells you to do. You just say, yes, sir. As an ambassador commissioned. My goodness, the power and the grace that will flow with that in your life. But you've got to tear down the old. You've got to build up the new. Hallelujah.